most of these companies, of course, don't have revenues, so you're not generating any cash other than share capital. But in the context of the mining industry or the junior mining development stage companies, what that means is that it's where you're making your financial decisions effectively. So if you've got five properties and they're all within the same area, and strategically you view those properties as one, even though you might disclose the five properties separately, you could still look at that as one cash generating unit. So when you're doing your impairment test, right, based on how much money you've spent or your market cap or your ability to raise financing, you want to look at your cash generating unit. Okay, now if you've got properties where you're making separate financial decisions, or if you've got your flagship property and other exploration ones, you could have more than one cash generating unit. So that's important to remember when doing an impairment test or impairment consideration, the NAV under IFRS is based on that cash generating unit. And a question that we often get asked, well, what happens when you have five properties, but we really just look at the whole thing, and for us it's really one, because they're so close to each other, that is one cash generating unit. And you do have the option to combine into one mineral property. You don't have to separate them all. You can if you want to, if you want to show your reader where you're spending the money on what block claims. But we have lots of companies who just choose a country and they have blocks all over it as giving one cash generating unit. So there are some choices out there. Most companies that we found that do the impairment test at year end, but there are quite a large chunk of them that do it at different points during the year. So remember, your impairment test, even though we typically encourage you to do it at year end, you can do it at another time of the year. We'll look at that.
Harris, have you had any feedback from regulators on the lines of why didn't you impair at Q3 or Q2 with obviously
a lot of things? Yeah, we certainly have. It's a good question, and I think we were going to address. Hey, look, it looks good on you.
Getting into the mood.
Good. Yep. That's going trick-or-treating after this. It's a good question, and we have. We've seen comments from the regulators. I'll jump into now a little bit about market cap. So that was one of a primary question. Looking at a public company who had a large balance of mineral property, and often the market cap was lower than the actual cost of the property. So we've gotten that question, and they've actually asked for companies provide documentation outside the scope of the disclosure of the financial statements detailing their analysis. So yes, it's happening. We think it's going to happen more. If you see the third point, probably about half the companies that we have seen have taken some sort of an impairment charge over the last 12 months. Sometimes it's written off completely, sometimes it's written off to a number. But given where we are in the marketplace, it's a hot topic, and it's something that we think more and more. So a lot of it started from Ontario. The Ontario Securities Commission kind of began the process of asking companies to provide them documentation, and we think that's starting to head out west as well. So back to Guy's comments earlier on, documentation is critical when analyzing impairment. A little bit on mine closure rehabilitation or asset retirement obligation, whichever terminology you prefer. By and large, we found that whoever did book an amount has disclosed the assumptions that you require to do the present value calculations, such as the risk-free interest rates, the life of mine, and so on. No real inconsistency there. We still find that most exploration stage companies either book some ARO or no ARO. Again, getting back to your comment, the commission has come back and asked for an analysis of what you have or why you have not booked an asset retirement obligation. Typically, when you do spend a significant amount of money on a property, there does tend to be an assumption that there's going to be some costs involved. Sometimes it's not deemed to be material, sometimes it's not estimable, but that question is coming around now, especially as exploration properties are being abandoned, transferred, or closed down, so something to watch out for. And now, at a perfect time, we'll get back a little bit on the regulatory world. So guys, we'll go back and forth, but we'll get into sort of, to feed off your question, what are the sort of the big things that the regulators are looking for the next 12 months?
Yeah, just trying to get into the old Halloween mood here. It's going to get worse in a few minutes. Just as a
highlight, the OSC put out a staff notice 52720. Now I represent our firm along with Dave Harris, another partner with the Mid-Sized Technical Forum, where we sit down with the institute and the regulators and the other accounting firms in town and walk through some of the issues out there. Certainly the OSC is taking a large part in some of the questions coming out west, and there's some other items that for instance BCSC will be looking for, and we'll just briefly go through some of those. But this is for your viewing if you wish to go there. 52720 is pretty much a synopsis of what the OSC is seeing as a deficiency in your financial statements. It's a good place to go and look because you know they are looking for you guys to be fixing it. The first one is business combinations and asset acquisitions. What is it when you're buying another company? And a res, in a few moments, I'll ask to step up and give you a little more discussion on that one. Impairment considerations, as a res mentioned, or a good question from the audience, what about your market cap versus your value of your properties? And not just necessarily properties, we're talking about impairment, your receivables, could be anything. Clearly, we're now looking for more disclosure on critical judgments and significant estimates. And non-boilerplate stuff, we all typically have a note in there, it's about this long, I remember it well, and it just kind of says a bunch of things, but it doesn't really tell you about what your company's decisions are in plain English, and that's really what they're looking for. Requesting documentation on judgment considerations and conclusions in complex accounting areas, again, things like impairment. Hey, may I please have your documentation show me what you considered to keep that mineral property or E&E asset at value or book when your cap rate, your market cap is very low. So they want us to make sure that we're documenting. You can't say that word enough. Where IFRS guidance is limited, you've got alternatives, document how you made your choice. A great example of that is reverse takeover transactions, which we're seeing a lot of today. I'll go through very briefly later on in the course a little bit about RTOs. And lastly, quarterly financial statements will still be required for TSXV filers. When we joined the IFRS world, almost had a little smile on my face for a minute because the IFRS world out there tends to not file quarterly statements, but rather semi-annual. And so you might have skipped a couple of quarters in there and taken a breather, maybe have a few more days of vacation. Not going to be the case, sorry to say that. I understand they are looking at the MD&A and there may be some reduction in terms of requirements in your MD&A, but you are still going to be required to file quarterly financial statements, not just semi-annual like the rest of the world. I think the res is going to come up and talk about asset or business acquisitions.
This is my favorite topic, I have to say. It's quite relevant because the main factor is because under Canadian GAAP versus IFRS, the definition of what makes a business is different than under Canadian GAAP. So what has happened is that you saw a lot of IFRS statements that treat acquisitions of a mineral property or a company, whatever it might be, as a business, whereas we look and you go, well, it's not a business, it's just an exploration property. And so why does that matter? Well, it matters a lot for two primary reasons. Well, the first one is because the accounting for the two types of transactions are completely different. So that's important. But secondary, which is often important to you, our clients, is that when you're calling a transaction a business acquisition, then all of a sudden your lawyer calls you up and says, well, guess what, you got to file a business acquisition report. And when you file a business acquisition report, that means you need to provide 1, 2, or 3 years of annual audited statements of the business that you acquired. And so that becomes problematic because, well, it's time, it's cost, and most importantly, it might not be right. Okay, so what I want to, and
I like this chart because it sort of gives you a little bit of a visualization of what an asset versus a business is. Okay, so and it's right here at that point, right here.
What you want to with the gray area. Okay, so if you're acquiring a mineral property.
So if you're acquiring a mineral property, right, and it's got resources, okay, resources typically means 43-101 report or something similar to that. It does not necessarily mean you've got a business, okay? It just means that so you might still have an asset. You might have done some work on it. There might be some preliminary calculations and so on, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's a business. It's really in this area right here between resources and reserves where there's the gray area. Once you've got a reserve report, you've got a feasibility study, it's pretty much business. You know, you're going to have a more difficult time marketing why it's not. If you've gone to that stage, that means you spent some money. And if you spend some money and you've got to figure out how much gold you've got on the ground, then it's probably a business. But this is, of course, the area where we're finding the most challenging because most mining companies, all related, oil and gas, whatever, might be, have resources, right? But not necessarily reserves. So on a number of transactions, primarily the TSX has come back and said, well, give us an analysis of whether or not it's an asset or a business. So they actually want a documentation, a memo from the company outlining, well, how did you conclude that it's an asset versus a business? So what is an asset versus a business? Okay, a business is something that has inputs, processes, and outputs. So it's kind of like in simple terms, it's got stuff in it, like employees or people who work for you. Processes, which means you know you've got some reserve on the ground, and outputs means that you're actually selling something. But by and large, if you've got revenues and you're producing, you're probably a business. But if you're not producing and you've got reserves, you could still be a business. So an input, almost everybody has. Most mineral properties have an input. Because they've got some geologist or some consultant. There's some sort of form where you input something. But the process part is the part that's great. And process really means if you've got buildings in place, if you've got equipment on the ground, if you've got drilling rigs, if you have a setup, you know, a setup that enables you to produce something, that could be a business. And of course, if you've got an output, that really means production. So by and large, most companies, unless you're selling, don't have outputs. But now the IFRS definition does say that if you've got potential outputs, ones that could be produced, then that could constitute a business. And that's where the reserve versus resources gray area comes in. So what we encourage you is that when you do have a transaction where you're acquiring a mineral property, and again, a mineral property is acquired versus in a company or by itself, and that part doesn't make a difference. If you're buying shares of a company versus just a mineral property from another, that's not where the big differences are. The big difference is it a business? When you enter into these transactions, I would argue that 95% of your typical mineral exploration deals are asset acquisitions. However, because the IFRS guidelines are different and the definition is expanded, we are seeing more feedback on the analysis. And going back to Guy's comment, the regulators are asking for more and more documentation from the company on their analysis, whether it be impairment or business. Practically, most acquisitions that previously called an asset will still be assets, but there are a few ones that fall in that gray area that you will need to look for further analysis. So if you are getting the feedback, you need to provide audited statements of the business for the last 2-3 years. Take a step back and just make sure it is a business first before you get into all the time costs that are associated with buying a business acquisition report. And we have gone through a number of TSX where they've asked for documentation, the company has provided it, and it suffices. So, that's what it is versus that. Now, a little bit more on impairments.
Our favorite line when somebody is asking us, gee, do we have to file a bar or not with respect to either an acquisition? Consult your lawyers.
impairment considerations, I'm just gonna finish off my, get myself a little more into the mood here.
This is what happens when you two have children. Anyway. Impairment,